2 weeks ago, I made a video talking about how I was moving away from Next.js for my new coding platform, Cosden Code. That video got a lot of attention. A lot of people were really interested in that. I've also made an X post about it, and it also got a lot of attention there as well. If you haven't seen the video, make sure to go check it out. I'll leave a link to it in the description down below because it is context for this video, which is basically the result of that migration. So in this video, I'm going to show you how I successfully migrated from Next.js to Tanstack Start, what my experience was like, what the code looks like, and all of the things that I learned along the way. And I have to say that I did learn a lot, and it turns out that nothing is perfect, not even Tanstack. Let's get into the video. All right, so let's directly jump into the code because that's where all of the main differences when it comes to Next.js and Tanstack Start actually are. Now, the first thing that I will say, and that's really the most important thing that you need to understand when you're choosing between either framework, is that Next.js is a server-first framework and Tanstack Start is a client-first framework. So in Next.js, if I come here, I have the actual old branch of my code. In Next.js, everything by default is on the server. So that's server components, server functions, and all of that, unless you specify otherwise. Right, so over here, right, we have this course page component here. This is an asynchronous component, so it runs on the server, and that has a lot of benefits. For example, you can fetch your data here directly on the server, you're not dealing with any re-renders, and you can essentially compute all of the data required for your components and just directly ship the HTML to the browser and then rehydrate it at a later point. If you want to have anything on the client in Next.js, you basically have to specify it yourself by using this use client directive here at the top. And this essentially acts as a hard line, a hard separator between the server and the client. And importantly, once you define this line over here, everything from this point onwards, so everything inside of this file, including everything that gets imported, is now on the client by default, and you cannot go back into the server. On Tanstack Start, things work a little bit differently. This is client first and you opt into server functionality. So the way that things work inside of Tanstack Start, here I have the same course template ID page over here. Everything functions through Tanstack Router, which is the navigation library that Tanstack Start actually uses. And everything happens through this loader function over here. This loader function, importantly, runs both on the server and also on the client. There is a distinction between the two. And here you can basically fetch all the same data that I had before. You can return any data that you want from this loader to then access in your component, and then you fetch and render your components through this loader function that way. So just like in Next.js, when you have a server component here, it basically computes everything and ships the HTML and then hydrates the HTML. The same thing also happens in Tanstack Start. When the user initially goes on a page or refreshes the page from the browser, this loader here gets run. All of the components that are currently here as well get run on the server. The HTML is generated and then sent over to the client. This is what we call server-side rendering, right? So from that point of view, all of these are exactly in the same way. The difference is what happens after that. So if the user then goes and navigates away to another page and then comes back here to the same page on the client using client navigation, so without reloading the browser, this same loader over here actually now runs on the client instead of on the server. And here's where you might have a little bit of confusion as to how this is actually working. You need to spend a little bit of time to actually wrap your head around this to really understand how this loader here can run both on the server and the client, especially when you consider the fact that, at least in my case, all of these things here are basically React query stuff, and I'm basically fetching something and then populating that same thing inside of the query client cache over here, which theoretically should be available on the server, but then also on the client. Now, the way that this works is through a very magical function that I've come to love from Tanstack Start, which is the create server function. So let me come here, let me go through the chain, let me find here a server function. Here, this create server function here, you are going to be using everywhere inside of your Tanstack Start application. This is basically a server action that you have in Next.js, with the only difference, I believe there might be more, but at least the one that I know of, is that these can actually be both get requests and post requests. So by default, if you don't specify anything over here, this is going to be a get request, but you can also come here and do method like this, and you can do post, and you can also specify a post request to make an action that is going to change something inside of your backend. Now, these server functions here are really cool because you can basically define them anywhere that you want inside of your application. You don't have to put a use server directive here at the top or inside of the function itself if you're using it inside of a client component. And what's also really cool is that these work both on the server and on the client. And here's how that works. And this is also very important for you to understand. So let me go here to another function because I want to have a function that actually goes into the database over here. So here, let's open up this one over here. I'm going to open up these options over here and I'm going to find the get lesson submissions function over here. And this one is also another server function, but this one specifically goes into the database by calling this get lesson submissions for lesson template, right? So this one over here, you can see that I'm using db.query.lessonSubmissions and getting all of these submissions here. So the way that create server functions work is they are basically isomorphic, which means that they have a different behavior based on where they are actually running. So in the case of a server, so if we're inside of this loader over here on the initial server side render pass where all of this runs on the server, then over here, nothing is really different. Nothing is special. All of this code here runs exactly as is on the server because this here on the server, you have access to the database, you have access to all of the server environment variables, and everything works exactly as is. Now, anytime after that, so anytime that we do a client side navigation, this loader here now runs on the client and this server function here gets converted into an RPC call that is basically making a request to your server from the client to run the same code over here. Right? So this is just like a server action in Next.js. It becomes an actual endpoint that your application is going to call, right? An RPC, and then get the data or make the update in exactly the same way. And this is really cool because this is all done automatically for you and you don't have to manage anything. You just create here the server function and everything works out of the box. Right, so the only way that this loader over here can run seamlessly on both the server and the client is if everything within it is actually wrapped in these create server functions, because otherwise you are going to be leaking things in the client from the server. And so this idea of leaking something from the server to the client is not something that is only present in Next.js. It's also present in Tanstack because you're dealing with the server in both frameworks. Now, the second big difference between Tanstack Start and Next.js is that for the most part in Next.js, you're doing your data fetching directly inside of your server components in asynchronous components. You're usually maybe calling the database directly and getting your data that way. In Tanstack Start, you're actually usually going through React query instead. Now, you don't have to. You can actually fetch your data here using any function that you want, even calling the database directly, again, if it's under a create server function, and then you can return your data here like I'm doing for some of my data and then consume it directly inside of the component here. But generally, you want to use React Query for this because it's part of the same stack. It integrates really nicely, and then you get all of the benefits of having React Query as your asynchronous state management solution. And the cool thing about Tanstack Start is it actually handles all of the deserialization of the query client state, the cache from the server to the client, automatically. So again, back here to this loader over here, all of these things here are basically using React Query. I'm calling here ensure query data, and here I'm calling fetch query, right? This is basically going into the query client here, fetching the query, this fetch query function, that's what it does. It's first going to check the cache if the data is there, and if it's there, is it stale or not? And based off of that, it may or may not fetch the data, and then it populates that inside of the query client cache directly, which then is accessible if I come in here and I find my reviews over here, which then is accessible directly using the use suspense queries hook here on the client using that same query here, in this case for the reviews, right? The query client is automatically serialized and deserialized and then sent over from the server to the client by Tanstack Start automatically. And so Tanstack Start really shines when you want to use all of the other pieces of the Tanstack, right? When you want to use React Query inside of your application, which generally implies that you want to have more interactivity into your applications, which was the case for me. If you don't want to use React Query, then maybe you're better off using Next.js instead. When I was using Next.js, there was actually no React Query anywhere in my application. The only thing that I had is I just had the query client provider to basically set up React Query to actually be used, but I found myself not needing to use it, and I actually found myself it going against all of this data fetching here on the server. Now, to be fair, you can also do the same exact thing here with Next.js. You can actually fetch React Query on the server and then pass it in a dehydrated way to the client as well. But you have to do that manually, and it kind of feels like you're doing two different things, at least in my opinion. With Tanstack, everything is well integrated, and for the most part, it just works. And also, one huge benefit of having React Query in your application is when doing mutations, and specifically, even if you want to do optimistic mutations. Mutations are extremely difficult to do in Next.js because you're dealing with the server cache and everything around it. And if you want to do an optimistic mutation, good luck, have fun. There's not really an official way to actually do that. I don't even think it's in the React docs. If you, in Tanstack Start, want to do the mutation, everything is super simple because you're going through React Query. Everything is cached by React Query and the query keys. And to make a mutation, all that you have to do is invalidate the specific query key that you want to have invalidated based on the mutation. Right, so for example, here I have a course review dialog component. Again, I really like that I don't have to put use client here at the top at all. Everything just works on the server and on the client by default, which is really nice. And here I basically have my mutation over here, right? I'm creating a course review. And based off of that, I'm just here manually invalidating all of these specific query keys that I want to have invalidated, right? This is a really useful way to actually invalidate your things, and it makes making mutations super simple. Now, granted, again, in Next.js, you can also do that. You just do it differently by using revalidate path and then revalidate tag, right? But I generally, personally, found myself much easier to work with React Query simply because I know React Query a lot better and I'm more familiar with it, and it's easier for me to manage the cache of React Query than to manage the server cache. Now, this brings me really nicely to the last big difference between Next.js and Tanstack Start, and that has to do with the cache. The general caching philosophy of both Next.js and Tanstack Start are completely different. Next.js is leaning heavily into the concept of server caching, which basically means that your data is actually cached on the servers that are actually running the application. So if you're a user, right, and you visit the page, you load some data, right, and then that data is cached, right, using Next.js, using the use cache directive or any other directive that you want, and then you have another user that goes to the same page, they are going to get the cached data instead of making another fetch. This is happening at the server level of Next.js. In Tanstack Start, this is different, and you don't have this server-first cache. Instead, what you have is you have the traditional cache that you can implement at the CDN level using a header. So for example, here, if I go here to platform and I find my index page over here, you can see that here, I'm actually rendering some headers over here, which is the cache control headers, right? These are respected by any browser, right? You can put this in a CDN and you can basically control exactly how you want your cache to actually behave. This also has the flexibility that it pretty much works with any CDN or any delivery network that you have. Right, this is how caching looks like in Tanstack Start. Now, to do that, you have to actually come here inside of your Vite config, I believe, and you have to come in here and you have to specify here in the Tanstack Start configuration all of the pages here that you want to pre-render, right, to basically cache at build time. And here I specified all of the pages that I basically care about. I haven't fully delved into all the caching and all the things that I can do. This is still yet to be optimized, but I'm getting there. Right, so depending on the actual needs of your application and how much you want to specifically cache something and how much control you want to have your cache, and honestly, even how you want to actually use your cache, if you like to use these directives or not, right, this might factor into your decision to either use Next or to either use Tanstack Start. Cool, so now with this, we covered all of the main code differences when it comes to both frameworks. Let me now tell you about all the things that I don't like about Tanstack Start and all of the issues that I've specifically faced when using it. So the first thing that I don't like about Tanstack Start, and this is something that you will miss if you're coming from Next.js, is the quality and the amount of documentation that actually is there. Tanstack Start, unfortunately, does not have good documentation, and a lot of the things that you typically would want or examples or any depth to it is just not there, right? There's a lot of times that I found myself looking at the documentation and hitting a roadblock and basically not finding the information that I needed. And when you compare that to Next.js, you are really going to feel the difference. Next.js has very good documentation, is very well explained. There's a bunch of examples here, a bunch of tutorials and stuff that you can use to actually make sure that you're using the framework in the way that it's meant to be used. What I personally had to do quite a lot on Tanstack, which I don't really like to do, is I had to specifically go and join the Tanstack Discord and then go to the start section over there and look at all the questions and hope that somebody asked the question or had the same problem that I did. And to be fair, for the most part, I actually found the solution on the Discord, but I would love to see the solution actually in the documentation with some examples to actually support it and to explain why it's the solution. And ultimately, when you have that, what ends up happening is you're never really sure if you're actually using the framework in the correct way. For example, let me come here to my code, let me come here to index and then DB over here. Look at this. I have here my get database function. This is using create server only function. So this is different than the create server function that I've shown previously. This, to my understanding, is only ever going to run on the server and it's not going to do anything on the client. I had to wrap all of this logic over here of basically exporting my DB here inside of this over here, because otherwise it was leaking something into the client. Now, I don't fully understand why that was the case. Maybe I was doing something wrong, quite fair enough, but I'm not the only one who had this issue. And this is the solution that I found on the Discord to actually do. Now, again, I don't find this anywhere in the docs. I do find create server only function, but I don't find any examples with a database or any reason why you had to do that. And I mean, I didn't have to do this in Next.js, and I was also using my database all across the project in Next.js as well. And here in Tanstack, I'm only ever using this DB here in server functions, which are isomorphic by default. So again, I don't really understand why I had to do this, but again, I did it and it works. Another example is this start file over here, start.ts over here. And here, notice it's inside of src. So over here, right, it's src and then start.ts. This seems like an official file and even an essential file, something that you want to have in your application. This is basically here for the global middleware, just like you have your middleware.ts inside of Next.js. This file over here is only ever mentioned once in the documentation, and that is on the actual documentations of how to create a global middleware. But if you look here at the bottom of here, what I'm doing is I'm doing create start over here, which seems very official, right? Like you're creating the start instance, right? Which maybe feels like it's required. This is not. If you don't provide this, everything is going to work automatically. And I can only assume that Tanstack Start is doing this for you behind the scenes. And if you do provide it, it is going to use it. And then you're going to have access to your global middleware here. But basically, this is, again, confusion. Is this something that is necessary? Is it not, right? Why is it so official when it's not necessary? Why is it only for middleware, right? I don't get it. And it's not explained in the docs. Right? So if you're migrating from Next.js to Tanstack, you have to keep that in mind that the locks are going to be missing. The last thing that I will talk about is, because this is still RC, right? It's still version 0. It's not yet in a stable release. There still are some bugs that actually, at the time of filming this, are unresolved, and they're actually making a problem inside of my code. So here I have a file where I have a server function, this get lesson conversation function over here. It's using create server function here. Everything is fine until we get over here to the bottom, where I have here a to do saying that this type inference is not working here due to a union type. And then here I have ESLint disable next line, which currently, for some reason, I did some things to my TypeScript and now it's okay. I think I need to change this because any should not be allowed in my project. But basically, I had to typecast these initial messages as any. Otherwise, if I don't over here, you're going to see that we have an error inside of this server function here. Now, this error is a nasty error and I don't fully understand it, but essentially it boils down to type unknown is not assignable to type empty curly braces. This is basically coming from my type over here, this lesson chat message, which I'm basically returning here as this variable here, and I'm returning it here from the server function. This one is actually a UI message directly from the Vercel AI SDK, which basically has a union somewhere, right? So union in its type, and currently unions are not supported, at least to my understanding, in server functions. There's no clear solution for this. The only solution that I had to do was to cast this as any, and then here disable the ESLint to tell me that any is not allowed, and just kind of assume that it's going to work and hope for a fix in the future. That's a problem that I actually posted about on the Discord, and one of the core maintainers told me that they are working on a solution to opt out of something. But again, it's not really clear what's actually happening, because this same type over here, I basically copied the whole function right from Next.js. It was working fine in Next.js, but it's now not in Tanstack Start. And again, I attribute this to being a release candidate, and hopefully this will get fixed by stable version 1. And so there you go. That's it. Now you have my whole migration to Tanstack Start from Next.js. That has been my experience overall. This is what the code looks like. These are the things that are different. I would love to know your thoughts in the comments down below, what you think about this, and if you would consider Tanstack Start as your framework, or if you'd rather stick to Next.js. From my personal experience, again, the migration has been successful. I'm almost ready to deploy this. I'm just checking for bugs, right? Because I basically refactored the entire application, but I generally feel good, and I still feel that Tanstack Start is a much better fit for the type of application that I'm building, even with all of the drawbacks. Going back to what I said in the beginning of the video, nothing is perfect, not even Tanstack, and even Next.js is not perfect. And you really have to pick the tool that is right for the product that you're building and for the team that you're building it with. And for me, that is Tanstack Start. So there you go. That's it. That's all that I have for this video for you today. If you've enjoyed this video, make sure to leave it a big thumbs up. You can also click here to subscribe, or you can click here to watch a different video of mine that YouTube seems to think that you're really going to enjoy. And with that being said, my name has been Darius Cosden. This is Cosden Solutions. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Ciao, ciao.